Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining once again on Data Science. Can you hear me well? Okay, great. Thank you. So let me summarize what we've done so far, and then we'll go ahead for today's class. So far what we have seen is to the last class, we finished our packages of data science. And within packages, we have seen NumPy, we have seen Pandas, we have seen Matplotlib, and we have seen Seaborn. Specifically yesterday, we saw Seaborn, how we can plot multiple things, or plot different kinds of plots that can help us to visualize data, multidimensional data in different sensors, in different plots. We saw that different plots reveal different kinds of information regarding the data, which is very important because data visualization is a major part of data science. Now we are actually shifting gears. We are moving towards, or we are getting more close towards data science, where we do something called as data pre-processing. Data pre-processing is a major part. And then as I go ahead, I will explain what the individual concepts are. Let me go ahead. So a normal question that should come into our mind is why do we need to pre-process data? What is the purpose behind pre-processing? And what is the need behind pre-processing as well? So for that, probably one major answer is that the data in the real world is dirty. Okay. So the data in the real world is dirty. That forces us for pre-processing data. So then the next logical question is, what do we mean by dirty? Okay, it's not that it is dust, you know, there's dust in the data, or our hard disks are not clean. Question is, what do you mean by dirty? So here, when I say dirty, I want to focus on three main attributes, that is incomplete, noisy, and inconsistencies. So let's see each of them. When I say data is incomplete, basically what I'm saying is there are missing attribute values, or they lack certain attributes of interest, or they contain only aggregate data. Okay, so let me show you some example. Let's say I have data of this form. I have rows and columns. So let me draw a few columns. Let me say there are features F1, F2, F3, there's a target, Y. And then I have different rows of information. I've got 1, 2, 3, 5, 4, maybe 1,000 data points. Okay. Now within this data points, when I say that data is incomplete or missing attribute values, that means that there are certain attributes here. Let's say F1, F2 has some missing values here. Let's say this data is missing, this data is missing, this data is missing, this data is missing. So many times we come across these real scenarios where we have multiple features, multiple rows of data, not everything is missing. So if I have all the rows as missing, it basically says that this data is useless for me. I have to get rid of this data because I don't have F1, I don't have F2, I don't have F3. I don't know if I have target or not. I don't know why this row exists. So then the situation is very clear that we cannot use this data. We delete them. The problem comes when the data is incomplete. Not everything is missing. So in the row 1, we can see that F2, F3, Y exist. F1 is not there. Okay. In that sense, if we get rid of this data, we are also getting rid of this known information that we have. Okay. Which, if you have loads and loads of data, it is fine. But when your data is limited, so in this case, I have only 1,000 examples. If I remove this row, then I'm losing an important bit of my information. But I cannot use this directly also because I've got incomplete or missing data. So that is what we mean by incomplete data. Okay. Or it can be such that they lack certain attributes of interest. They lack certain attributes of interest. Means for the problem that I'm trying to solve, there is some feature that I require which is not present here. Okay. So something like I'm trying to look at a medical problem where someone has overweight issues. Okay. and if someone is obese or if someone is thin, or we are trying to find what are health disorders based on weight. Okay. And an important parameter is BMI, and we see that for this data, we don't have BMI collected. Okay. And that could also mean incomplete data. That means that it's an important attribute of interest for us, and that important attribute of interest may help us solve the problem. But whoever has collected this data, or however we have collected this data, we don't have that information. Okay, that information is lost. And if that is the case, again, I have incomplete data, so I'll have to do something about it. Okay. Either I would say that, okay, sorry boss, this cannot be done. Go back, start a new campaign, start collecting new information, new data. That is one solution. Or I could use the existing features that I have and combine them in some interesting ways so that I can get my required answer. Okay. So there are different ways of handling this thing. Sometimes we see that it only contains aggregate data. Okay. That means if I am, let's say, interested in finding out the temperature of this room, okay, and for that purpose I need sensors at different places, but what I have is I have the common temperature. I don't have the individual temperatures. Okay, whoever was collecting the data, either them or we had lack of sensors, or there can be so many other reasons why this could have happened, but we have aggregated. We've got sum of data. We don't have the individual data points. So let's there can be many examples. We talk about such things, and here I'm showing you an example where, let's say, we're collecting a data and you have a survey form and someone has to write occupation, but they have left it empty. Again, that is a simple example of incomplete data. So in the real world, such cases are very, very common. And we would see that a major part of our pre-processing would include taking care of missing values. Okay. Very rarely we are very lucky that we don't have missing values, but generally we've got plenty of missing values to deal with. Other reason or other place where we say that data is dirty is the data is noisy. So what do we mean by noisy? By noisy we mean that the data contains errors or outliers. Okay. The data contains errors or outliers. So let's take an example of this. So we have a salary column, and for that, one of the data points is minus 10. Now, this is clearly an error because you cannot have a salary of minus 10. It makes absolutely no sense. Okay, so either when the data was transmitted, something has gone wrong, or when the data was collected, or maybe it was a form, handwritten form, and someone was feeding the data into the database and that person has made a mistake. There could be many reasons for that, but when we deal with noisy data, when we come across with errors within the data, we have to do something about it. Otherwise, your model will not work out well. Your model will give you an answer that is unreliable. Sometimes we have outliers in our data. Outliers are points which are way above the normal, way above or below or way different from the normal. Okay, so let's say if you're doing housing price data, and we understand that common areas within the house can go from 1,000 square feet to maybe even 5,000 square feet. Okay, but let's say you come across a house which has their area as 50,000 square feet. So you know for sure that this is clearly either we are talking about a huge palace, or we are talking about some different space, or there is some error within the data. Okay, there is some error within data. No one can have a house of 50,000 square feet. Or at least if they have a house, then that is away from the normal. It cannot be dealt with the same way as you're dealing with other data points. The third problem is there can be inconsistencies with the data. So what do you mean by inconsistencies? If there are multiple different kinds of... let me show you three examples of inconsistencies. An example one is you have two columns. One is called as age, one is called as birthday, and they have mentioned the age as 42. They have mentioned the birthday as someone from the year 1997. Okay. Now, both of them cannot be true. Either the age 42 is true, which makes the birthday wrong, or the birthday is true, which makes the age wrong. Okay. I'm assuming we are in, like, we are talking about right now. So here, we have to deal with it. Okay, we have to either ignore one, convert the other, or we have to do something about it so that we are not feeding, that we are not feeding wrong information to our body. Okay, there could be other inconsistencies, like you are looking at ratings, and in the early part of your code, in the, let's say you have 10,000 data points, in the first 5,000 data points, the ratings have been mentioned as 1, 2, 3. In the next 5,000 data points, the ratings have been mentioned as ABC. So what must have happened? The website or whatever was collecting the data, the means or methodology changed. They updated the website, then they collected data, or they updated the survey form, then they collected the data. That could be a reason for these inconsistencies. And sometimes we have discrepancies between duplicate records. Okay, you have two records and both records have many things in, similar, but there are some changes, there are some differences. And in those cases also, we'll have to deal with it. Okay. So why do we pre-process data? We pre-process data for data science because the data is dirty. Then I showed you three examples of how the data can be dirty. It can be either incomplete or noisy or inconsistent. Going ahead, why pre-processing is important? We saw why pre-process is required. We see why pre-processing is important. So the idea is simple. Garbage in is equal to garbage out. The way machine learning algorithms work is they you're looking at a system, you're feeding in data to this model, and you're expecting data to come out of this model. You're expecting prediction to come out of this model. If you train with wrong data, if you train with garbage data, you will get garbage out. Okay, the authenticity of your predictions, of your predictive model, is only there if you are feeding good quality data. If you are feeding bad quality data, that bad quality data will help you learn bad patterns or wrong patterns. Okay, that may not be helpful for you in the future. Okay, so that is one key. I have put up here a small comic. Let me read it out for you. This is a conversation between a boss and an employee. The boss says, "Are you sure the data you gave me is correct?" The employee says, "I've been giving you incorrect data for years. This is the first time you have asked." "What?" He says, "Okay, I said the data is totally accurate." Okay. So the thing is, if our data is incorrect or if our data is garbage, you will not even know if your model is giving out wrong answers. You will be under the assumption that your model is working out fine. And only once you deploy it into the market and you get a major failure in your production, or your conversions are not happening, that will be the hint, or that will rectify, or that will tell you that your data is wrong. Okay, so it is much better to deal with your data pre-processing within while your project is still going on, in the initial parts of your project. Okay. Now, there's another grave reality with data pre-processing, which is that data collection, cleaning, and preparation takes 80% time and budget. Okay, you will see very soon that when we start working on a data science project, we will spend 80% or even more time on just pre-processing the data. Okay, so that takes a huge time, whereas modeling the data or training the data, trying to do predictions, trying to figure out problems within the machine learning step are relatively much easier, and it takes less time compared to the data collection, cleaning, and preparation, okay, which is huge. Here, thus, if that is the case, then we need to be well acquainted with what is pre-processing, and we should not skip this step. Okay, we should have tools with us that will help us to know that how, what we can do and how we can work this out. Okay. So going ahead, what are the major tasks in data pre-processing? So the major tasks in data pre-processing is data cleaning, data integration, data transformation, data reduction, data discretization. We'll look at each of them in detail. But of course, this list is again not exhaustive. There can be more things that we do in data pre-processing. But these are the most commonly done things on data repository. We have to do data cleaning. What is data cleaning? It is filling in the missing values, smoothing the noisy data, identifying or removing outliers in noisy data, and resolving inconsistencies. So all that we talked about in the last step, basically we manage in data cleaning. We also do something called as data integration, which is integration of multiple databases or files. So when you have multiple data sets, so if you remember our movie lens example, we had files like ratings.csv, we had tags.csv and movies.csv. And we had to do a step where we were merging ratings.csv and movies.csv together. So that is data integration. Okay. So sometimes we have to do data integration. We have to do data transformation at times, which is either normalization or aggregation. And I'll talk about this and the options that we have in the next few slides to come. We have to do data reduction. That is obtain reduced representation in volume, but produce the same or similar analytical results. So I'll talk about this. What is the purpose behind this? And finally, data discretization for numerical data. Let's look at data cleaning. So data cleaning basically involves filling missing values, dealing with noisy data, correcting inconsistent data, and removing redundancy caused by data integration. Okay. So when we are doing the first step, that is dealing with missing values, what do we do? How do we solve this problem? There are multiple approaches to that. One basic and bad approach would be that ignore the tuple. As I showed you earlier, let me try and get this graph there. Okay. So ignoring the tuple or loss of information is basically taking a certain row and saying, I don't need this row, I don't need this row, I don't need this row, I don't need this row. So whichever row has some missing element of data, we simply ignore that data. And that is one approach in solving the missing data problem. The problem with this approach is we have loss of information. So if your data is less, if you have just 1,000 data points, then we should not do this step. If you have millions of data points, then I would say this is an easier step to do, we should do it. Because why do you want to spend time when you have millions of data, your model can still generalize well. Okay. So in this case, at least for our case right now, ignoring the tuple is not a very good option. What other options we have? The other option we have to fill manually, and this is tedious and infeasible. So what I can do is, I can look at this data, go to where the data was collected and see what data, well, recollect that data basically. Okay. You can ask whoever filled this data, what is the value that should be filled here. Sometimes that is possible, sometimes that is not even possible. Okay. Other step is, I will try to guess what this value is depending upon these other patterns. Okay. I will look at these other patterns and say, okay, if for row 1, F2 has this sample and F3 has this sample, I guess that F1 will have a certain sample. I will also read the other parts of F1 and get some idea on what should be fed here. So this can be done, but if you're doing this manually, this is tedious and invisible. Just imagine 1,000 data points, 1,000 rows of information, of which maybe 400 have missing values in one feature or the other. And we have to sit and figure out and find out what would be the value that is filled, which is a very hard task. It is tedious, it is infeasible. So I would strongly recommend not to do this. Then what is left with us is basically filling it out automatically. And that is the most important part. And we do it a lot within our data science projects. That is, we want to fill the missing values automatically. So when you want to fill the missing values automatically, what do you fill with? What is the data that you fill with? There are multiple things that you can do. One is you could try to create a new class or a global constant called as unknown. So let's say that F1 is categorical data. And this categorical data has different types, type A, type B, type C. If there are missing values, what I can do is I can create a new class type D. And I can say all these missing values belong to this new class. That is one way of filling. But what we're doing here, we are adding something new to our data. Okay, we are adding some new data, which sometimes works well, sometimes may not work well. I generally do not do this. Okay? I do not add additional data to my model where something is new or something that the model has not seen before. What is the other option we have? The other option we have is we can take the active. That means we of this data and we say, okay, out of these 1,000 data points, in this case, let's say 2 are missing. I will take all of the other points, take its mean value, that is take its average and replace these missing values with these average points. Okay. So that is one way that we are filling out this missing data. The third way, so this mean is done for numerical data. And if I have categorical data, I would go ahead and do the median or mode. Okay. Either of them works out. You can try different examples for your projects and see which one is giving you better results. Okay. But generally, if numerical data, we fill with mean. If categorical data, we fill with either median or mode. Okay. The third thing to do is to take an educated guess. Okay. So what do I mean by educated guess? Do I mean fill it manually? No, I'm talking about some rules or some thumb rules that you can come across by looking at other data points. If you see that F2, generally for all the other data points, has come some correlation with F1, then you can use F2 to fill the information in F1. Or you can use a combination of F2, F3 to fill the data in F1. Okay? So the other parts of our data may give us some hints on what should be the missing value there. And in those cases, in some cases, we can use that as well. Okay. So when we come across, okay, in the classes to come, when we come across real examples, or when we go to examples that we look at our data science project, we'll see how we are filling out missing values based on hints from other parts of the data. Okay. So maybe one point that I want to add, which I have seen some of my other students making a mistake, is they try to get too creative with filling missing values. Okay. Now, the problem with getting too creative in filling missing values is, first thing we have to remember that this data actually does not exist. Okay, we don't have access to this data. Since we don't have access to this data, we are trying to create artificial data. Now, when we are creating artificial data, you would not want this artificial data to disturb the initial distribution of your original data. Okay. For this F1, let's say for the 1,000 points, 20 data points are missing. Okay. So if all the other 980 data points had a minimum value of, let's say, 5 and a maximum value of, let's say, 100, then when I fill this 20 missing values, I want to be somewhere inside this range. I do not want my new data to disturb this data. I cannot put a value like 5,000. Okay. Because if I put this value 5,000, these 20 data points will overpower the original data sets. Or I don't want it to put like 0 because that was not part of my original data. So generally, our strategy should be such that when we are trying to fill out missing values, we are trying to fill out something that is nominal, something that is normal, okay, something that will not disturb the distribution of your data or will not create too much artificial data that your model will get confused. Okay. We want to be within the bounds of the original data range. And that is the reason we actually go for mean, median, and mode. So mean, median, and modes are actually average representations of our data. Okay. So average value here, so it does not disturb our original distribution. Median and mode also do the same thing. Okay, someone is asking, what is the need to fill missing data? So a major need to fill missing data. So as I discussed earlier, right? First, garbage in, garbage out. So if you have missing data, your model will not be able to understand what is happening. Okay, another major reason is basically most of our machine learning models will not accept missing values. It cannot learn from missing values. So that is the major reason that we cannot we cannot continue with missing values in our model. We have to fill with them. Now we are trying to see what are the ways that we can fill them up. And so these are some of the ways that we are targeting. Okay. So I hope this part is clear. Let me go ahead. The other part that we do with data cleaning is binning or smoothing things out. Okay. So what is the purpose behind that? Now, binning or smoothing is not just a data cleaning measure. It is also a data, go ahead. So we use that even in data discretization. We use that even in data reduction and so on. So it's a very standard step that we do. And the purpose behind that step is we want to reduce the noise from our model. Okay, we want to reduce the noise from our model. What could be the reason for that is when you explore your data, you will find out many of the times that your data has too much information and that too much information may not be required by your model. Your model can actually do much better if the data was a bit more dumb. Okay, the data did not have too much detail in it. So let me share an example. So let's say you have students' information, you have student data, and we have a column called as age. Okay, and in that column called as age, what you generally expect is we expect that we have the years. Okay, but let's say that column has has age in the form of days. So you know the exact number of days from someone's birthday till the present day. Now that is too much information. In fact, if I represent my age in terms of days to my model will try to find out something which is not present, something that I'm not interested in. Then it would make a lot of sense for me that instead of giving age in days, I will give something that is more useful. Okay, I will convert those days into years, or maybe a month and a year, that is June of 1997 or October of 1955, whatever. Okay. So that is a little bit more denoised. Okay. So what I've done is I have taken out the extra detail that I had in my data. I have removed that extra detail so that my model does not get confused. My model is will know what to focus on, okay, and so on. So that is one of the reasons that we would want to smooth things out or bin things out. So let me show you what do we exactly mean by binning. So here, let's say I have this data. This is a sorted data with different data points like 4, 8, 9, 15, 21, 25, and so on. And I have several different values, okay. So maybe here I'm guessing I have maybe 10 unique values. Sometimes these 10 unique values, and let's say this is just for these many points, and if I have thousands of such data, then this could be a lot of noise for my model, especially if I'm not interested in the individual values. Then I would have, then what could we do with this? We could say that instead of individual values, we can divide them into bins, or we can divide them into groups, and those groups will be what we feed to the model. So instead of all of these individual data points, we can feed to our model groups like bin 1, bin 2, bin 3. Okay. Now, the way that we divide this bin can be different and we can do several different things for that. But that could be one strategy. Instead of giving all these unique data points to my model, which may confuse the model, especially when this feature is not very, or my model is not very, my prediction is not very sensitive to it. In those cases, we would want to group things up. Okay, so now to group things up, there are three ways that I'm showing you that can be multiple ways, of course. We can partition into equi-size bins, that is, sort all of the data, see that these are 12 data points. So we divide them into four groups, divide them into three groups. 4 to 15, one group. 21 to 25, one group. And 26 to 34, another group. So that is one way. We can partition our data into equi-size bins. Other option is we can smooth by bin boundaries. Okay, that means we have these three groups, but in these three groups, we would replace our data by something like this. Okay, so whatever is the data we have, we move it to the lower boundary. So here the lower boundary is 4, so 8 and 9 becomes lower boundary, and 15 stays as the upper boundary is 15. Or we can do this for the next data point, 21, 21, 24, we take 24, move it to the lower boundary, or we, what do you say, pull it or hold it to the lower boundary and keep the upper boundary as it is. Okay. Or we could do something else, we could take this to the upper boundary, or we can divide the data in the center and say, before the center point, we would take it to the lower boundary. After the center point, we will take it to the higher boundary. So we can actually do a lot of things. We can get creative in how we are trying to bin this ideas, or how we are trying to change the idea. We can also go take a bin and replace it by the mean value there. All of these things, what we are doing is, you can see that we are losing out data. Okay, we are losing out, we are missing out data. And that was the purpose here, that we are trying to smooth things out. When we come across our first data, I think once we finish our theory for data preprocessing, we will look at an example. And when we look at that example, we will be looking at something called as a Titanic dataset. So within that dataset, then we will get an idea of how actually this binning or smoothing works out. Okay. Let me go ahead. How to handle outliers? So let's look at this. So we have within the data cleaning process, we also have to deal with outliers, or we have to deal with erroneous data. And let's see how we do that. Okay. So data points are inconsistent. What do we mean by outliers? That these data points are inconsistent with the majority of the data. Let me show you one more example. So when we have an outlier, so let's say you're looking at the salaries of people in a company. You have different ranges here. So let's say on the x-axis, you've got salary, and so here, let's say you have samples, and here you've got salaries. And what you would see is normally your salary varies between this range. Most of your data points are here. And sometimes what may happen is, if you're looking at the CEO, the salary would be something like here. Okay. Or if you're looking at high post, your salary, some of the salaries may be here. Now we can see that most of our data lies within this range, but some of our data lies in the above range. These are examples of outliers. Okay, they are valid examples. It's not that this data is wrong. This data is actually correct, but it is very much different from our model. So we call them as outliers. What do we call as noise? A noise is, let's say we are looking at the age of people, and one such example is an age of 200. So we know for sure that the age 200 cannot happen. Especially when you're talking about human ages, the age of 200 cannot happen in our modern world, at least that we see so far. And that would mean that is basically a noise. That's not an outlier. That's a noise. Okay. Either ways, we can deal with noise or we can deal with outliers using methods like clustering or curve fitting. Let me show you examples of that. So. Let's say we have our data points like this. Okay, we have most of our data points like this. And here we have a data point here or here. Okay. In this case, how we can deal with outliers or missing values is, first, in this case, we are able to visualize it well. And you're able to visualize it because I've just plotted two dimensions. Okay. But in most of our data science problems, we will see that we will have actually multi-dimensional data. You'll have multiple features, you'll have multiple columns. And in that case, it will be very difficult to even visualize something like this. You will not be able to know if something is an outlier or not. When we do a method called as clustering, clustering is actually an unsupervised machine learning method, which we will see later down in our course. When we look at that, we would want to take the data points and we would want to group them together. So when we group them together, we can find out how many clusters is formed. Okay. In this case, we can say there are two clusters that are formed. Okay, one is having many data points and one cluster is having very less or minimal data points. In those cases, we would know that this cluster is actually either outliers or this cluster is noise. Okay. And once we know what these clusters are, what these outliers or noise are, then we can do one of two things. We can pull this down here. That means we will now manually, we would want to modify these individual values so that they come somewhere in the center of the cluster. Either that, or we can delete this altogether. Okay. Now, there's a difference between deleting. I said earlier that missing values we will generally not delete, or we don't want to delete. So that is one part. We don't want to delete missing values because it has some information that is of use for us. Here, if you fill this data, then this data may actually corrupt your model, or it can give it can disturb your model. In which case, if you do something like remove this data points, that is a valid solution. Okay, removing the data point is a valid solution because keeping the data is doing more harm than removing it. So that is one point. The other point is I can move it to this, and when I move it within this range, then it's a bit better. Okay, why is it a bit better? Because then it will at least allow us to use the other features that this data may have used and get rid of the features that bound the features that may not be of interest for us. So we can know these clusters by using clustering, which is an unsupervised method, which we will see later on. Okay. Another method is doing something called as curve fitting. So let me show you an example of that. If we see that most of our data lies within this range, okay. So if we have data and we see our data is distributed within this range, and I have some other data points which are maybe far away from here, what we can do is, instead of clustering to help us find out what went wrong, we can do something called as curve fitting. So when we do curve fitting, the idea is, one second. Yes, the idea is that we will try to represent this data using an equation. In most cases, we want to fill it using a polynomial. So when we fit this data to a polynomial, we will come up with this kind of a representation. See, which basically says that I have this this equation, this line. In this case, this seems to be order 3 line, so I will have an equation like y is equal to ax cubed plus bx squared plus cx plus d. So I have an equation like this, and the coefficients a, b, c, d along with x, they help me come out with this line. So now we see that if my data points are close to this line, then they are normal data points, they are valid data points, I don't want to mess with them. But if I look at the error between my prediction, that is our equation, and the other outliers, we can see there's a lot of difference. And if there's a lot of difference, what we can do is we can use this line to pull this information down here. We would say that instead of coming to this point for this x value, instead of using this data, I will actually evaluate what is the x and I will use this line information. So that is another way of dealing with outliers or dealing with noise. Okay, we are trying to remove them, but we are trying to remove them. As I said earlier, either we totally delete this information, that is one option, or if this data point has other important features which can be of use for us, we actually pull them down to our more nominal data sets. Okay, in clustering, we pull them down to our clusters. In curve fitting, we pull them down to our equation. So those are ways that we can deal with outliers. Let's quickly go to the next point. The next point is data integration. So what is data integration? Data integration is basically combining data from multiple sources together. We can do schema integration, which is integrating metadata from multiple sources. So combined data from multiple sources, you've got different surveys that was generated, and these different surveys that were generated have different forms of information. They are not the same data points. They are different data points that we have, and we are trying to combine them from multiple sources into one major one data set that you can work on with the examples. The other is something called a schema integration. So schema integration basically means that you have data, but you have data collected in different forms, in different schemas, in different surveys from the same set. In that sense, we would want to do schema integration. In our case, I think when we did when we merged ratings and to movies, that would be an example of schema integration. Now, when we are doing this, when we are trying to combine data or when we are trying to integrate data, there may be problems sometimes. The problems are there may be some conflicts. That is, we have one data set says that I for the same ID, I have an age of, let's say, 15 years. And the other data set says from the same ID, I have an age of 25 years. Now, that's a value conflict. And if we are dealing with a value conflict, we have to have means of detecting them and resolving them. Okay, someone has asked, what is metadata? So metadata is basically additional data that you have regarding your model. So let me show you an example. If you have, let's say, an image file on your system, your image file has certain data. Okay, so what is that data? Your image file will have your image, it will have pixels, image of a man, person, dog, whatever. But when you store this to your computer, you have certain additional information like file name. Okay, now this is not part of the original data. That is, the original data is what? Your original data is just pixels of information. But you have file name, which gives you some hint, that is some data, some extra data regarding this data. Okay, you may have the date on which it was created, or the date at which it was saved, or date which it was modified. You may have the size of the data, that is how much space it is taking. You may have something like author, or you may have media, where using what was this image clicked? Did you click that image using your mobile phone? Did you use it camera? Did you get a scan? Did you download it from somewhere? So these are additional information that we have about our data. Okay, our original data is basically these pixels of information, right? But we have this, all of this extra data are called as metadata. I hope that helps. So sometimes we could actually integrate this metadata, and we can add this additional data within the columns of our information as well. So along with your original data, we can have this additional information, which can be of use. Many of times it is actually of use to our machine learning algorithm. So the problems after we try to combine them is we will have certain conflicts which we would want to detect and resolve. Okay? Or we would want to remove duplicates and redundant data. So many of the times duplicate and redundant data, they don't help us. They are not adding additional information to our model. They are just probably complicating things or confusing things. Okay. So how do we deal with those then? So within pandas, there are different within pandas when we are trying to deal with data points, there are several ways. So if you remember, when we are trying to integrate data from multiple sources, we talked about four different kinds of joins: inner join, outer join, left join, right join. And those joins help us to at least give priority on what to do when we have data conflicts, or what to do when we have certain missing values, or we have certain data points from one data set which does not belong in the other data set, and so on. Okay. So we can use methods like that. Removing duplicates and redundant data is actually a bit more advanced. We can use a clustering algorithm to cluster data points together. And once we see that if there are multiple data points within a given cluster, we can either sample some of them so that we can have a reduced representation. That is one idea. Even within pandas, there are methods of removing duplicates or just keeping the unique values, and we can see that once we come across to examples. Okay. Going ahead, we are looking at data transformation. Now, there are, when you look at data transformation, there are two major philosophies. One is called as normalization, which is also called as min-max scaling. And the other method is standardization. Now, standardization is also represented by Z-score normalization. So what does that mean? So many of the times our different features have different ranges of data. Okay, we have some features which have ranges varying from, let's say, -5 to +5. In the same data, we may have some features. So by features, I basically mean columns. We may have some columns. We may have some columns in the range, maybe thousands of range, from 10,000 to 50,000. We may have some columns which are discrete values, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. So once we have these huge discrepancies in the different range of our features, our machine learning models actually get confused on what to give more importance, what to give less importance. In that case, if we don't want the individual data points of our features to influence priority of the different columns, then we should basically do one step before sending it to the model. And one step is transformation based on either normalization or standardization. What we're trying to do is we are trying to scale our data into a normal scale so that all the different features come within similar scale, so that our algorithm does not prioritize one feature over the other. It will you take the best of all the features. To make that happen, there are two ways. One is min-max normalization. With the min-max normalization, what we do is we will scale everything in the same range. Okay, that same range here is basically new min and new max. Whatever was the old min and old max of our model, we generally want to scale it to a new range, which is new min and new max. Okay. So that is one way. In most cases, this new min and new max are actually 0 and 1. So we take all of our data points and we scale them to a range between 0 and 1. Okay. So this idea is very, very simple. We are basically taking each data point. We are saying, let me subtract the minimum value. So when you subtract the minimum value, what you have is you have numbers that goes from 0 till the max value. Okay. So from any data set, if you subtract the minimum value, you have all these data points will go from 0 to the max value. Okay. Now we take that and we divide that by the range. So max minus min, when you divide that by the range, the maximum value here will be max, the minimum value will be min. So max minus min will actually give you 1. So 1 divided, max minus min divided by max minus min again will give you 1. So you see, by doing this transformation, your minimum value will be 0, your max value will be 1. Further, if you want to change the scale to a different range, so you say, I don't want the range 0 to 1, I in fact want the range 5 to 15. Then, once you have this scale which goes from 0 to 1, you multiply by 15 minus 5, which is multiply this by 10. So instead of 0 to 1, you are multiplying by 10, you have 0 to 10. And once you have that, you add the minimum value, which is 5. You get a range from 5 to 10. Okay. I think that was confusing. Let me maybe show you a simple example of it. Okay. So let me just take 4 data points. And these 4 data points have the value 2, 5, 3, and 7. Okay. Let's say if these are the 4 data points that I have, what is the range of this data? So I can say the range of this data is from 2 to 7. Two max values. Now let's say I want to transform this data to a new value, and in that new value I want the range 0 to 10. Okay. So if I want to take this data and I want to transform it to the range 0 to 10, what should I do? So min-max scaling says that what you should do is from each of the data points you subtract the minimum value. Okay, so let us do that. We'll do step 1, v minus min. So our minimum value here is 2. From each data point, when you subtract 2, you end up with 0, 3, 1, and 5. Okay. Now we say let us also divide it by max minus min. Okay. So when you divide by max minus min, max minus min is 7 minus 2, which is 5. So when you divide them by 5, 0 by 5 is 0, 3 by 5 is, okay, 3 by 5 is what, 0.6? Yes, 1 by 5 is 0.2, and 5 by 5 is 1. So now we see this range has become from 0 to 1. I have minimum value of 0, I have maximum value of 1. Get by this part. Now we want to transform this in the range 0 to 10. So to transform this into range 0 to 10, we have to multiply it by new max minus new min. New max is 10, new min is 0. So you're multiplying it by 10 minus 0 and add, you're adding 0. Okay, so that just simply goes away. We're just basically multiplying this by 10. So our new scale is 0 times 10 is 0, 6 times 10 is 0.6 times 10 is 6, 2 and 10. So what we have done is we have transformed our range from 2 to 7 to this new range 0 to 10. Okay, this data, this new data has the same distribution as this data. Okay, just that we are now able to look at a different range. So what is the advantage of this? If I have 5 features, feature 1, if I have, let's say, 3 features, these different features are of different ranges. This is maybe 0 to 1, this is minus 5 to 15, this is 0 to 10,000. Okay, and I say that all of these features are in different ranges. This may actually confuse my model, and what I want to do is I want to transform this into a common range, and we choose let the common range be 0 to 5. Okay, then we can do data transformation with normalization so that we end up with all the features f1, f2, f3, they end up in the same range. Okay, and there is advantage in that. The advantage is that now our machine learning model will not get confused on the priority of the features. It will give equal priority to all three features. Okay. Similarly, we have something called as Z-score normalization, which we also call as standardization. Here also we are transforming the data, but instead of subtracting the min value, instead of subtracting the minimum value, we are subtracting the mean value or the average value. Okay. So basically, by doing that, let me show. So in the normal scale, if your mean, if your data looks like this, okay, where you say I have an average of 20 and I have a standard deviation of around 2, then when we try to do Z-score normalization, first you're subtracting the mean value. So from this data, the mean is 20. When you take this distribution and you subtract 20, you see that this entire curve comes here. So we are basically saying subtracting the mean is taking the same curve. I'm trying to draw it as equal as possible, taking the same curve and then pushing it here at the zero mean value. So that is the first step. Second step is we divide by the standard deviation. So when you divide by the standard deviation, you end up with a standard deviation of 1. Okay. So after transforming it, your data would look maybe something like this. Maybe something like this, which says that now this data has zero mean and it has this standard deviation. Okay. Now this is generally what we do with our standard deviation, the height will not change. Let me undo this. And let me say that, okay, this will be our data. So this is what your standardization does. The advantage is, again, same thing. If I have multiple features, with different ranges, when I do standardization, I'm saying that all of these features will have a zero mean and all of these features will have a standard deviation of 1, which is very useful for training our model. So with this, we have looked at data transformation. In the next class, we'll look at data reduction and data discretization. And if there is time pending, we'll actually go to our dataset, Titanic dataset, and we'll try some examples of data preprocessing. Okay. So with this, let me stop sharing. We'll stop here for now. Okay. Thank you so much for attending this class. That's it. Neeja ma'am, I'll exit now. Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye.